Hello and welcome to another edition of Motor Capital. We'll look at this Michigan historic marker here showing the inner urbans. And I was not aware of how extensive the interurbans were. It was a little bit before my time, but they extended all the way to the other side of the state. It says here's Michigan's first interurban, the Ypsilanti and Ann Arbor, began operating in 1890. So you can do a little speed reading here. Cars leaving every 90 minutes. 10 cents one way. Well, that was affordable. Of course, that was back in the day. The last interurban from Ypsilanti ran in 1929. Well, yeah, that was way before my time. It was 1960 where I first showed up on the planet. But we had mass transit back then, and now we have the Q line and the people mover, so we're kind of getting back to that. But Ypsilanti has some history with the bombers, and we'll check that out. We're in historic Depot Town, a nice neighborhood in Ypsilanti, and as you might expect, it's near the railroad tracks. That kind of makes sense. But some nice historic buildings. And my sister Michelle and I had lunch here at the Sidetrack, aptly named because it's right by the side of the track here. And then across the street, or kitty corner, is a historic building here. I think it a couple years back had a fire, but look at this. It's coming back here in the fall of 2019, and they're going to make lofts. It's called the Thompson Block. Here's the train station. It's boarded up now. You would think that would present a possibility of maybe a restaurant or something like that. That seems like it would work. They have a marketplace over on the other side of the tracks. It was the freight house. Now it's community events and hall rentals. And they have another historic marker here commemorating the involvement that Ypsilanti had in the War of Liberation. A lot of servicemen from Ypsilanti served in the Civil War. And across the way, we'll look at some of the businesses here. And here, we just saw the Thompson building. So nice. That was from back in the day, what it looked like. North River Street.
Oh, no, I got a house.
Maybe it was a hotel. Yeah, well, it said at one time it was destroyed by fire. Now, the real McCoy, check this out. I did not know Elijah McCoy, quite the inventor. And a little more speed reading if you can do this here, but he invented several things to help oil the engines, the locomotives, and so forth. Look at that, over 40 patents. And you've maybe heard the expression, the real McCoy. Yeah, well, there it goes, the real McCoy, in quotes. That's an expression still used to this day. Well, we'll check out the clock and see if it's accurate. So it looks like we are in sync, which is a good thing. So a nice little place here where you can rest your weary feet. We'll catch this. Well, this is Cross Street, the main street that I'm going down here in Depot Town. And we'll check out that Hudson dealership. Is life worth living? Well, yes, indeedy. All right, coin shop here, and a nice body shop, and you can do your yoga. I like their logo there, and there's like a phallic symbol. If you go in downtown Ypsilanti, it's hard not to see that, but that's a brewery. And here's a great park, the Frog Island Park, and so the Huron River passes through here. And they have a bunch of walkways crisscrossing back and forth. You can get One with Nature. Little big rock there, kind of diverting the water around it a little bit. But yeah, it's quite nice. They got a gazebo. Years ago, they had a, while I was out here, they had a Camaro show. And I have a 67 Camaro in the garage. Yeah, I need to get that fixed. But maybe if I do, I'll come out. If they still have that Camaro show in the summer, I'll bring it out there and show it off a little bit. Okay, Maze, it's a Mexican restaurant. Never been there, but several people have said that's a good place. Here's the Hudson Auto Museum. And they have a beer garden out back, which is nice. Actually, it's a combined thing. Coffee and tap house across the way. My sister wanted to check this out. Ypsilanti Food Co-op. They have one in Ann Arbor that she patronizes quite a bit. I got myself some good nacho chips. So we had a good lunch here at the Sidetrack, ate outdoors. Can't see it, but beer is the proof that God loves us and wants us to be happy. And that's a quote from Benjamin Franklin. Just trust me, or have faith in me, that beer was the word in front of there. But so B24s, that's a coffee house. I'll patronize that place in just a little bit. This is Michigan Avenue I'm on now. Here's a few of the businesses. They have Fast Eddie's Music. Then they have First Fridays, that's been around since 2013. They have a good music scene in Ypsilanti, I can attest to that, but I never attended First Fridays. And then here, an old theater, they got Melon Fest showing. And at first I thought, is that a movie? But deja vu. So it's one of those adults only kind of places. But yeah, I guess they wink wink, show their melons. That was a radio station there on the corner. And then they have an ice cream shop and a nice mural on the side of the building. So they do have the art scene going. Murals are all the rage. We're going to get some of that in a little bit. Now, the tap room, I'm aware of. I've seen some bands perform in here back in a few years back. They got burgers and cocktails. I like those neon signs. And look how the positioning of the door handle. Now, as the story goes, so I'm told, is that they had a lot of midgets that would do the riveting and stuff like in the belly of these bombers because it was advantageous for them because they weren't that tall and they could do some of that tough work, get in those tight spaces and do the riveting. So that's what I'm told. You know, that's my story. I'm going to stick to it. I should have gone in and verified again with the bartender, but I'm pretty sure that's correct. So the arsenal of democracy, a big thing, because, yeah, they certainly made the bombers out there at Willow Run Airport. That's where we have Rosie the Riveter and all that kind of stuff. Harriet Tubman here talking about the Underground Railroad. So, wow-wee, there was a lot of history. Okay, I got to switch tapes here, or switch camcorders. Okay, sorry about that little delay. Okay, Eastern Market after dark, and it certainly was dark here on this particular day. It was Thursday. Well, this particular night. There was a little light shining up. There was an artist here that was painting this mural. He was just taking a break. It was picture time. And there were a lot of people, even viewers, checking it out via the bicycle thing there. Bicycle transport. But yeah, this is a thing they've had going on for several years. It's part of the design, Detroit by Design, or Sun River Design. It's a month-long event that they have, and they got events like all the time through the whole month. It definitely did, and it's well done. And here's Roma, a nice Italian restaurant. So, yeah, there were artists painting murals on this particular night. which is interesting to be sure. And this is Chucky's ride. And I've seen this before at Theater Bazaar and the Nain Rouge Parade. He gets around, so that's quite the ride. Well, look at this young lady with the hula hoop. We'll see her in action when we get inside here, the market. But I'm entering the market from the north end, and a lot of DJs. Let's listen in. Good, but that song, I kind of think that's a little racist, don't you? Play that funky music, white boy. Play that funky music until you die. Oh my lord. Yeah, it's got racist overtones, but just the same, I mean, I have to admit, it's an awesome tune. So that's a lot of fun. All right, this is an art park here that just popped up maybe last year, I think. So I'm just taking a quick look inside here. A lot of people put their handprints, and of course, Eastern Market, known for vegetables and goodies and so forth. So you would expect a mural like that. And then that looks like a bear there. I don't know if that's a plastic thing or if that's actually carved. I should have seen if that was a real bush. All right, Paradise Valley here. Burt's has a nice operation going over here. And this Eastern Market after dark had a huge crowd. And they had a lot of food trucks. And people had their dancing shoes on. And holy cow, that looks like a rhino. Quite the contraption there. Wow, there are some clever people indeed. Yeah, I think it's officially Design Month, Detroit Design Month. But it's a lot about architecture and urban planning. And here's an overview of the crowd. There were DJs playing music all over. Personal, not political. Design dignifies. Oh, you really have to do the speed reading here. But yeah, it's all about design, and design is important for sure. Design is love. Design speaks. Design listens. Well, design, well, it's everywhere. We are design, so it's a lot of good things. And they have a month, Drinks by Design. It's once a month they have a nice thing, and they go to a different venue somewhere in Detroit. And it's well done. They do good work. And Detroit is hip and hot again, just like it was back in the day. Detroit versus everybody. That's been quite popular. And they got a robot factory. And just so you don't lose your bearings, I got a map here. Yeah, there was a good crowd, a lot of 20, 30-somethings, those millennials and the like. This Russell Street Deli had to close because the landlord jacked up the rent. 30 years and 20 jobs down the drain. I think they'll resurface somewhere. That would be my idea. That's the way to downtown. And the Metro Times, what a great magazine to pick up what's happening in and around the city and so forth. They, you know, if you go through there, you'll get a half dozen to a dozen or more ideas of what you want to do on the weekend, and for that matter, during the week. This is one of the original murals, and then this was restored. Well, the first one was 1972, then this one restored in 2013. Bibios, well, the soup of the day is a loaded Bloody Mary. Wow, quite the soup. Never had it, but it sure sounds good. Here you get a look at the crowd here doing a little dancing. You can get an idea of the age bracket, but it was people of all ages. They had a map here of all the murals, so we'll get the opportunity to look at some of them in a bit. A look at some of the beers they offer here. These guys have been open, I think, for a couple years now, and they seem to be doing quite well. Now I'm going to check out the skate park in this alley here. Logo, Key to Life. All right. These are fairly new here. And they've been doing this murals in the market for, look at Austin, Texas was the artist there. It's been 3, maybe 4 years. And a lot of friendly people getting their transportation via the bike. That's a good way to go. That's climate friendly. The Tigers couldn't beat Cleveland. Like I think they won 1 out of 19 games. They got great burgers at Cutter's, and you can get a 2-pound burger for $15. And I've done the 1-pound burger before. I haven't done the 2-pound, but man versus food, maybe one of these days I'll do it. But I was going to get something there, but they were so busy. They had a good crowd. I just said, I got to keep moving on. So here's an artist, and he's doing his work here at night, but he's got a well-lit wall here, number 19, but he's going at it. Yeah, this event, I had trouble parking. I had to park across the the St. Or the DeQuender Cut in actually the school parking lot over there. I think it's the charter school, but had to park there and walk over. And it was like more people than I've seen, you know, at the normal market on Saturdays or even the big events like Flower Day. There was just a lot of people. Well, here I'm going to check the DeQuender cutout, and they have some nice music going down. So we're going to listen to this for a bit. We'll continue this show next week. I gotta go back again. Hang on. Okay. Back to Cutter's Burgers. I'm going back in time, actually, to Friday, September 13th. So it was Friday the 13th, but it was also a full moon. And I think I heard somewhere that it was going to be another 30 years before a full moon and a Friday the 13th coincided. But anyways, it sure hit me up hard. You know, sign everywhere, sign. Unfortunately, I was not able, I mean, I had seen it before, but I didn't pay close enough attention to it. But here it was a Friday evening. It was after 5, and I got nailed by a meter lady. I parked here at Division in Orleans. And they have these crosswalks. Now, this one's relatively close to the sidewalk entrance. And I would think the other one would be here, but it was way off from the curb. It's way over here. And I just was 2 feet shy of pulling up far enough. So, you know, these are handicap accessible. I think the ticket was written at like 519 or something. Yeah, so here was the lovely ticket. Well, let's see. So, yeah, Friday the 13th, crosswalk violation. So that knocked me back $45. Should I pay this? Oh, I just went inside to relax a little bit. Yeah, here's the sign. You got to park 30 feet from the corner. Well, yeah, 30 feet from the stop sign, 30 feet from a fire hydrant. But, you know, your back end to the back of the block. Look at this. Well, here's a nice mural. Then I got my measuring tape out. I just wanted to see just how this was going. There's the curb there. So here, the crosswalk. And you see I'm just over a foot. There was a car in front of me. I could have probably pulled a little closer, but I'm going, really? And it wasn't that crowded on this day. So I measured from the curb, you know, kind of was irritated. So that's 10 feet there. I'm just seeing how close to 30 feet I was away. Here's another 10 feet. So, and then here's another 10 feet, but it doesn't have to be 30. If I would have done 24 feet, I would have been good. So, yeah, a foot and a half, 2 feet, I was off. Damn. But, you know, the city has to make money somehow, right? It wasn't just me. That car got nailed, and a few other cars had already left, but there were like four of us there. So the meter certainly knew their thing, and that's why those signs were posted up on every street corner. And you better believe I'll catch that sign again. Yeah, that took the steam out of me. And then, well, earlier in the day, a stone got thrown up. I was driving Southfield Freeway, and a stone hit me on the side there. And like an hour later, when I came out, it just started spreading. And, pretty soon it'll be all the way across the windshield. But, yeah, that was lovely. So I wanted to make it home before lightning struck again. I had two strikes there. I figured the third one would be a charm for sure. Luckily, I made it home before any other damage was done. This is my favorite mural. I'm a car lover and so forth, and I think this one is well done. It was like, I think it was 2 years ago. I think maybe if I show the date, I think 2017. And I was down here, and the artist was working on this one. 67 Fastback. I got a 67 Camaro, but this is a 67 Fastback and a smoking hot babe. So I'm hoping if I get my 67 done, maybe that'll attract those babes like a magnet. Probably not. I just don't have that dynamic personality, but I can only wish. Well, here's another Lions mural. Well done. And, yeah, money bags. That's what the city's doing on these parking. Yeah, I guess if you're into handing out tickets, you know what the routine is. You know where the hot spots are to nab people. And they're on their game. Yes, they are. This mural was done up with the in a Mercedes-Benz ad, and the artist was upset over it and wanted to get compensated for it. So I'm not quite sure where that's going to go. It's in court, and they haven't made a decision yet, but it'll be interesting to see if you can use public art and as a backdrop, use it in an advertising scene, or if you got to compensate the artist. So I don't know. I just showed the artwork there, but I might get in trouble now because they might say, hey, you didn't have permission to film our murals. I don't know what the story is going to be on that. Anyways, here's Airbnb, a nice place there. This, now that they shut down that trash incinerator and Eastern Market's all the rage, this neighborhood should be hot for new housing development. There's the Dequindre Cut, which is very popular with bicyclists. They did a great job of that. Here's some more murals. I'll get back to that. Here's the Velodrome. And they have the bike races there. And here, born in Detroit, 1960. So I'm starting to hear that old man kind of thing come up every now and then, rear its ugly head. So I guess I've crossed the threshold. I'm no young pup anymore. All right, this is going to be the last segment of the event. And this is at the Kemeny Recreation Center in Southwest Detroit. And Fox 2 News is out here. And we're going to see something here that Rashida Tlaib and another congressman have on the water and air quality and so forth. So there's a lot of concerns in Southwest Detroit because it bore here air and water quality. And so they're hosting an event here, free and open to the public. So this was on September 16th. Yeah, this borders like the big industrial area with Marathon Refinery and the like. And so here's the congressman from California, and they have a panel here. Let's listen in.
Who has been a dedicated leader on environmental issues on our subcommittee. It's a privilege to be able to visit her district and see firsthand, as we did this morning, how hard she's been working on behalf of the people of Detroit that make us cough or gag, that give us emphysema and aggregate our asthma. Safe from ingesting toxic chemicals and bacteria that jeopardize our children's brain development and weaken their immune systems. And this safety is not, it should never be, contingent upon where we live, the color of our skin, our income bracket, our party affiliation, or any other superficial differences that needlessly divide us. It makes me heartsick that the people of Detroit and Flint have been living without their basic rights and that they have lost trust in life. Let me read you some statistics from the most recent Detroit Community Health Assessment released last year by the Detroit Health Department. 38% of Detroit residents live in poverty, the highest percentage of any major U.S. city. The rate of infant mortality in Detroit is twice the rate of the state of Michigan. Detroit residents' life expectancy is lower than the statewide average in nearly every neighborhood. And the rate of emergency rooms in Detroit is nearly twice that of the rest of the state. 9% of children in Detroit have elevated levels of lead in their blood compared with 4% statewide. Other reports tell us that for 8 years, water and sewer costs in the city of Detroit have risen steadily, and already struggling low-income residents are paying approximately 10% of their monthly income on water bills. Water service has been shut off for many households in the city. And 5 years after public officials made the decision to switch its water supply, the city of Flint has still not fully recovered. Flint's mayor has still not declared the city's water safety threat. The city residents are paying money that can't afford for bottled water because they cannot trust the assurances that the crisis is over. We in Congress are working to demand accountability for the tragedy in Flint, and we want to ensure the crisis of this magnitude never happens again, and that we have safe drinking water not just in Detroit, not just in Flint, but throughout Michigan and our great country.
That's got all the industrial factories and processing plants and the like. It's pretty concentrated here in southwest Detroit, so it is an issue to be sure.
We're going to ensure that every single person has access to clean water. We take on these big fights because we don't have any other alternative. When people take to the streets to protest,
First Senator and Advocate, who I thank you again for taking the time to visit Sharif, the director of Climatizing Lockridge, the Climate and Environmental Justice Organization.
Oh, all the news crews were out here in force. A lot of people covering this event. And a lot of these press conferences can be a little dry, and it probably should be edited. They get like an hour, hour and a half of video, and then they put it on the news, and they got enough for like 1 minute. So we'll throw this out there and try to stick with it if you can.
From lobbyists of the very companies emitting in my company, in my community, write laws under which I must live, while they may not, clearly describing my community, collateral damage. I will give you two, what I call, home. I was sitting at my kitchen glass table that shook. I ran out the house screaming. There was no one outside. All of this was very strange and terrifying to me. Everyone was at work. Having lived through two Ford Motor Company explosions a few years back, I knew what an explosion sounded like and what it felt like, because each time of the Ford explosions, I had been in my basement. I live approximately 8 miles from that Ford Motor Company complex. It took me approximately 1 year to determine why every weekday between 3:15 illustration. Approximately 5 to 10 years ago, I unexpectedly drove into a mist, a vapor. I entered the mist, not realizing while driving that it was there. It began at the number 50 Marathon refinery storage tank and continued until I exited on the other side of the viaduct on Schaefer and at the 52 sites of heavy industry in a tiny little 3 mile area in River Rouge, Ecorse, Melvindale, and the 42-17 area. The article is very explicit in describing the living and health conditions caused by pollution. In March 29, 2016 article written by...
Yeah, that's the Tufts zip code, 48217, the most polluted in the state, and probably one of the most polluted in the country, actually. But if you drive down I-75 near the refinery, you can smell it, and you know exactly what they're talking about. The I-75, as it goes over the Rouge River. Oh, yeah.
This is an example of what happens when the needs of profit and industry are deemed more important than the needs of the people. Flint residents lost their local democratic rights, and their local elected officials had their powers.
If I'm the concentration of people of color in zip codes containing hazardous waste facilities was double that in zip codes without. He also found that the concentration of people of color in the zip codes was the best predictor of where such facilities are located, even when controlling for incomes and property values. In the late 1980s, I teamed with the best predictor. As faculty investigators of the U of M's 1990 Detroit area study, we conducted the first environmental injustice analysis in the metro. Over the years, I've conducted a number of national level...
Yeah, that's my favorite radio station, WWJ 950, and we'll get their take on the seminar here, or the Detroit hearing on water and air quality, and so they cover it pretty good.
Residents on the east side of Detroit closed down a trash incinerator. Residents around Southwest Michigan that are confronting issues of drinking water quality and affordability. Through my work with all of these communities, I've put a lot of things directly into that while our environmental law and tech are wider and more affluent communities, they fail to protect communities of color.
And then your own coffee wakes you up and you don't have a cold. And then your nose alerts you to the fact that there are chemicals in your bedroom. And you can't breathe, and they smell toxic, and they are choking you. These are the issues that we have experienced in an ongoing presence in our home for Marathon Petroleum Corporation over the years. What I have done personally for myself is when I have a chance at the doctor's office, I grab a mask, and I put it over my nose, and then I grab pillows and I put them over my head, and then I pull the covers over my head, and I try to get a few minutes of sleep. I have neighbors who have told me what they do is run to the kitchen, get some bleach, go to the basement, pour it down the drain, hoping that will help the odors subside. This is no way to live. And energy, the largest SO2 producer in this area, they were forced to live in these facilities. They were forced to be met by steel mills. And they didn't know, they thought they were giving us a better life, but what they were doing was shortening our lives when they moved here. I live, drive out of the parking lot, turn left, and I live directly across the street from Marathon Petroleum. That is where our subdivision is. Some people call it the North Pointon community. Some people call it the Jeffries community, where our school used to be. Some people call it Times to Show what the true story is.
Yeah.
But one of our neighbors came over and made me pictures anyway, because now they know what we're supposed to do.
Oh, yeah.
So environmental racism has had a huge impact on our lives, not just health. And when I say these health situations, science go, I'm going to leave you with a quote from Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. And this is what Dr. King said. He said, "It really boils down to this, that all life is interrelated. We are all caught up in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied into a single garment of destiny, a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one destiny affects all indirectly. In other words, there is no law around air pollution. What impacts us today? The canaries in the climate change day, that's who we are. What impacts us today reaches everyone at some point. So we need to earnestly work together to fix this. Our legislators, policymakers, environmental groups, industry, we need to sit at the table with them to work through this. And everyone who's concerned with the way of clean water, clean air.
I'm concerned with burnt effects. We literally had toxic gas leaks from Marathon last week, as you all know, which caused them to evacuate the plant, but not our neighborhoods. And it isn't just this neighborhood. Communities on the east side near PI Chrysler plant are exposed to some of the worst air pollution in the state of Michigan. And neighbors surrounding the U.S. Ecology Facility has been fighting against its expansion for years. So this is a Wayne County effort. The whole state is impacted by this. So Ms. Lockridge, what are communal impacts? And how is the law's failure?
Okay, well, Rashida Tlaib, she's my congresswoman, and certainly she's a fighter. And she's been known to get under little Trump's skin a little bit. The Donald. All right, this Kemeny Center, the residents fee of quite affordable, even the non-resident, not too bad. I'm going to catch a little fresh air, or maybe not all that fresh, but I mean, it wasn't too bad on this particular day, but there you can see, you can get your Speedway gas there. They have storage tanks. DET.com is the website. There's I-75, Kemeny Park there, right in the middle of your screen, just below that 43. And Southwest Detroit, it's in the yellow there. But just south of the Rouge River, she's got the Dorothy. Maybe she can click her heels and make it all go away. But Fox 2 News was getting an exclusive interview here.
To ensure that is going to stay. Marathon's line, our goal.
Every day. So we have to work to hold Marathon accountable every day that it continues to happen.
They have a question and answer session going on right now. And we'll listen to this a little bit, and then I'll take a tour of the neighborhood.
I'm not gonna lie to you, there will be days when you're gonna be tired, you're gonna
carry on.
It's not making a difference. But none of these environmental justice victories that I've ever worked on, that I've ever heard about, or that nobody's told me about, have ever come easy. They've never been, you know, we worked on it for a week and then it was done.
Okay, here's where all the goodies are centered here, mainly in this 48217 area. But River Rouge, E-Course certainly affected, Melvindale, Southwest Dearborn, the Ford Rouge plant, you see right there. You know, but the Rouge plant's been there for a while, so heavy industry, you know, it's all about urban planning. So heavy industry, kind of, I don't have a problem with them kind of centering heavy industry in one place. Maybe they should work on moving some of these houses, letting people relocate.
Countries on the face of the earth who were not participating in the Paris Climate Accord. That was Syria and Nicaragua, who have since joined the Paris Climate Accord. So the only country that has not made a commitment to the Paris Climate Accord is the Trump administration. And that abdicated leadership is why it's more important for all of us in this room and for us on our committee work to continue to shine bright light.
This is a first term congressman from California, as is Rashida Tlaib. She's a rookie there in their first terms.
That's why the overriding narrative of this subcommittee's work is on climate change. Past, present, future. What did we know? What did we know? And why didn't we do anything about it? Present, understanding the true human and economic impact of climate change. And by the way, it's easier to predict the economic impact, and it's easy to predict the human impact when you literally have to count the number of people who have lost their homes or died because of climate change events. What becomes harder is understanding the impact of climate change when you're dealing with the illnesses, whether it is wildfires in California that are causing increased asthma, or the pollution that you deal with every single day, both in your air and soil pollution, the healthcare impact there. And then we're going to talk about the future and have two very clear avenues. The idea that
play an incredibly central role in addressing environmental racism in our country in the fight against corporate assault on our families, and that's exactly what it is. And that corporate greed is driving a lot of these policies, and it's not specific policies. Sometimes it's just the policies doing nothing. They're just deciding not to do anything, right? That is also a set policy, and it's so critically important that we elevate the voices of so many residents that are not in this room, that are dealing with this on a daily basis, every single day, and now their children. I want to thank, of course, my state representative just walked in, Ms. Cynthia Johnson. Thank you so much for the work that we're doing on a national level. If you are holding corporate polluters here locally accountable here, and it's critically important as we proceed to push forward policy that is more humane and more just for all of us. But again, I can't thank you all enough for helping put the human face to it. Please know that this is just the beginning. I know from hearing all of you, it has refueled me to be even more committed to elevating your voices, but also fighting against environmental racism and corporate greed. But we and the federal level and Congress need to do more, and we know that. But you all doing this and showing up reconfirms for us, kind of greed gets us committed again to really trying to push forward. And the one thing I've learned, and you all know this, many of you talk to me about how's it going, it's your first year. And I tell you, there seems to be this lack of urgency, you know? And I just want you to know, this makes us feel like, okay, we have to move quicker. Yes, this is urgent, this is 911, we gotta move. You know, how many times do we need to study the fact that we're dying? We don't need that anymore. So just know that all of your work is so important, and it's this partnership, this kind of level of partnership that's going to be able to get us transformative change for all of us in our communities. Thank you all so much. I'm incredibly, incredibly proud of representing you in the United States Congress.
I was going to ask, why do you think you can do more in Congress in the third year of Congress? Well, candidly, the bar was fairly low, but that aside, we have an obligation as members of Congress, wherever we go, to remember that we have a podium and a microphone, and that we need to use that podium and that microphone to shine a bright light on the issues affecting our country and our communities. And that's why I'm very proud to serve with Congresswoman Gouley. Quote earlier, I may not have the exact, but I shall do my best. Martin Luther King Jr. Said that we and our ancestors may have come over on different boats, but we are all in the same boat now. So let's work together and address the issues facing us. Thank you. This is very important.
Well, that was a nice hearing, and it just concluded here at 3:43 in the afternoon. And some reporters wanted their questions. We'll take another look at the map here. Ford Motor Company, Cadillac Asphalt, Marathon. Yeah, those stickers are right on top of each other. And so a lot of goodies. Well, you have to have heavy industry somewhere. Everybody certainly will say not in my backyard, the NIMBYs. Yeah, and they still got to work on Flint. But yeah, you could put it out in the country, but you'd find people that are against it there. It's just you got to work with people and try to do best on the air and water quality, but also try to relocate people. And Marathon has done some of that. We'll check out one of the neighborhoods where they have moved people. Here outside in this Kemeny Center, they got all the phone numbers here if you want to contact something or do something with the city of Detroit. I just wanted to check out the facility. They had a second basketball court, and then they had another meeting room for the elite press to get their little canned interviews or so forth. I tried to step inside, but it was off limits to Motor Capital. Darn. But that's okay. I'm kind of off the beaten path a little bit. Here they quoted Martin Luther King several times in the meeting, but out here in the lobby they have several quotes, and quite the quotable gentleman Dr. King was. And, man, he died way before his time. He was fighting against the Vietnam War and fighting for social justice. And he had you go from one issue to the next. You're never short on issues to fight for. And he was the person that understood that. Yeah. That was a sad day when he passed, for sure. But, yeah, a lot of good quotes. All right, so a beautiful center that they got going. The conference is still going on. So they have a game room here, a pool, the foosball. So I stepped outside, and they really did a good job on the whole park, the whole thing. They got a kids thing. The refinery is there, and here, welcome to Detroit, founded in 1701. A lot of traffic on I-75, to be sure. And, but a nice little green space here, and we'll take another look at the map. So just south of the park, Kemeny, little green space, and 75 goes over the Rouge River. And so we'll check out the neighborhood a little bit. I got some Christmas trees going here, but don't get any ideas. Like, they're not for you to use, but yeah, they are like perfect size there, though, aren't they? Here's some soccer fields. I got a couple, a nice picnic shelter. So it's probably well used, but yeah, the air quality probably not the best, but at least it's a green space. You got to do that. Now, this used to be a baseball back in the day, but now the Detroit Pistons made it into a basketball, and they're three-time NBA champions, and we'll get the years here shortly. I got to get the other side of the ball. There we go. 89, 1990, and 2004. They planted some new trees. They got a bicycle, walking, jogging path. They got all that here. So, yeah, they did a nice job. Basketball court, so some people shooting the hoops. And it was a decent cloud day. It did not rain, as far as I can recall, that day, but threatening clouds. This is Fort Street, and that's the map on my phone there. We're going to go by the Marathon Petroleum Corporation. That's a, I believe that's a training center there, but this is part of the refinery. So it's got some industrial art going on. And then when you get to Fort Street in Oakwood, this is where Marathon had bought out a bunch of homes. And phase one, they got a bridge park coming summer of 2016. Well, they cleared a lot of the homes, but I don't see that that park per se. There used to be the Bridge Bar right where I'm standing here now, and I patronized that place for a few years. And that was quite interesting because the building was leaning. It was quite, you could notice it quite visually. I wanted to put a level on it, but it was off by quite a bit. Well, here's some youngsters with their mom, and they're all excited. They were doing a little fishing here in the Rouge River. They hadn't caught anything yet, but this is the recently restored bridge. And just down the way, they have a tugboat here. And they'll dock the Diamond Queen, the Diamond Jack, and they got the neighborhood watch here. In fact, there was a neighbor watching me that was out on the porch saying, "Hey, what are you doing? What are you videotaping?" And he was a holdout. He had it was a young guy, but his dad owned the home and two homes down the way. Now, they have a Marathon Gardens. But they weren't selling their property. They decided to stick it out. But the older gentleman had health problems. So, yeah, they were a lot of complaints, certainly. And asthma and all those breathing things, that was certainly an issue with people that live in this neighborhood. But they're making a park over here, getting back to nature. And so you might as well have green spaces. Why not? That doesn't hurt anything. But yeah, they bought back a lot of homes in this neighborhood and then the other side of Oakwood. And maybe they have to extend those offers to other residents that would like to move and give them a fair price for their home and moving expenses and the like. But I mean, there's so many businesses. I don't know. I guess you could leave that up for lawyers to divvy it up how they would do that. But it's poorer neighborhoods, obviously, and some people don't have the choice as far as what they can afford. So obviously, houses are cheaper, rents cheaper, and all that kind of stuff in neighborhoods where you have to deal with the pollution and whatnot. Ideally, you wouldn't have homes in this area, but I don't know what came first, the chicken or the egg. I mean, some of these houses might have been here before the heavy industry, the Rouge plant certainly. Oh, that dog had me checked out. I didn't want to get too close. You don't know if those leashes or those chains can bust loose. But, yeah, it's all green space here now. They cleared out a lot of homes. Now, this home probably will get torn down. Here's a holdout. It has a nice home. And yeah, they probably spent some money fixing it up and doing it up. And home is home. So if they want to stay there, that certainly is their prerogative. Somebody's got a nice garage there. Certainly the green space suitable for geese here. They were doing some work here underground, some of the sewer pipes and the like. So now getting near the top of the hour. The original Ganellas. Let's see if I got time to step inside. I got myself a good sub. This, I went to school with Vince Ganella. We graduated in 1978 from Edsel Ford, but I had never stopped inside here. I got the 12-layer meat, 2-layer provolone, $7. Very affordable sub. I was really quite pleased with what I ended up with. and it was a great tasting sub. And they even have a Ganella's Coke, and they sell Mackinac Island fudge. $7. I got a Faygo original grape. They'll have to stay for next week. Folks, thanks for watching. Good night.